Congratulations, and with that comes the penalty of having to be very active in just about everything that faces our state. So I want to talk a little about water, and then if we have time, I'd like to talk about money. And so I saved the really tantalizing part for last. But it's a little ironic to be discussing drought on the day that we finally get some rain. But let me put your, let's say, falsely positioned complacency to rest. This does not solve the drought. It's blessed, it's needed, the flowers will appreciate it, but we still have a serious problem, and I'd like to talk about that as soon as I figure out how to work the clip. I went the wrong way.
Hey, Troy. Yes,
sir. Troy, what did I do wrong? There, got the back to there, and I bet that's the way to
go. There we go.
All right.
Okay, we're good.
So here's what we have in store, and I apologize to those of you who may have seen my online talk. A few of the slides are the same, but I assure you, the message that I have here today is very, very different. It's not one of complacency, it's one of urgency. But I do want to talk about the system. And that's the Central Arizona Project. I'm privileged right now to be the president of the board. It's an elected board of 15 members from the three counties that are served by the CAP. And that responsibility is pretty serious. Over half of the water that we enjoy here in Maricopa County comes from the Colorado River because of this little canal that was built, finished back in the early 1980s. It's 3,300, it runs from the Colorado River to Tucson. It's 333 miles long. And we'll talk a little about little of those facts and figures. The basin that the Colorado drains, and which is sort of our common backyard, and then what we're facing right now in terms of a water shortage and what we can do about it. So I want to make it clear that we got good news and bad news. You hear that too often, I know. The good news is that we in Arizona, I think, could take justifiable pride in the hard work that was done planning for the crisis that we face today. That started really with the initial work by Senator Hayden on the Central Arizona Project. But for him, we probably wouldn't have this particular ditch so flowing in the center part of our state. Governor Bruce Babbitt was the one that hammered through the groundwater code for the state of Arizona, which made the funding possible. They weren't going to release the dollars from Washington until the groundwater situation was taken care of. And that was in the early 80s. So bear in mind the crisis that California faced a few years ago. They hadn't thought about how to manage their groundwater until the drought just hit them in the face. And Arizona had done it. We could be a little smug. We had done it long before. So we planned well, and the people right now that are facing the most urgent shortage have seen it coming. It's primarily the agricultural interests in Maricopa, Pinal, and somewhat Pima County. And they're going to be cut off based on the things we're going to go over here today. But they knew it. It's not a deprivation of their rights. They had their eyes wide open, and they knew it was coming. The rest of us, it's not quite the Lake Havasu, the Havasupai Falls is the picture on the right of the slide. And I take that as sort of the idyllic version of the Colorado River. That's as good as it gets. It will continue to flow, but the rest of our future is not quite as good as it is in that area. So we're in a new reality, and we need to face up to that. And that's going to be a challenge for our state. It's going to be a challenge for the entire basin. So here's a picture of the canal, the ditch. It can be beautiful. As I said, it's a long one. It's one of the longest in the world. I'm told it can be seen from outer space.
Wow.
Not had the opportunity to actually do that, but it's one of the few things that you can see from a long way away. There's the map. Basically, you can see it going from the Colorado River in Parker all the way to south of Tucson. And it has, and the numbers are a little awe-inspiring. It has to lift the water 3,000 feet, 10 siphons, 4 tunnels, We are the largest power user in the state of Arizona, which is a little like being a big debtor to the bank. When you get big enough, it's a question of whether they own you or you own them. So we have the rather remarkable ability to stop and start these pumps, which means if the time of crisis is one of the reasons Arizona has not had brownouts, as California has suffered in the past few years, is that if we get an emergency call from the utility company, we can actually stop the pumps on a moment's notice and stop the drain on the system so that it won't be short somewhere else. In 1985, the water got from the CAP to Phoenix. I was privileged to be mayor that day, and they gave us a little piece of water, a little jug of water from the CAP, supposedly the first water to arrive in the city of Phoenix from the new canal. I put it on my shelf in the office. 3 years later, it was bright green. And I never could quite figure out whether, you know, was this really a problem, or was that just an example of how healthy it was? But that was our water. And at the time, the slogan that we saw was, "Our lifeline is online." Uh-huh. And that was literally true. The lifeline for Central Arizona came through that straw, through that water. In 1993, it was finally finished in Tucson. And now that's the completed project that we're trying to keep operating. Service area, it's a big part of our state. 5 million people, 80% of the Arizona population, 350,000 acres of irrigated farmland, 11 tribal governments. So we serve a lot, even though it's just three counties. It is a huge part of our economy, a huge part of what makes up Arizona. All right, here's what it breaks down. I mean, people are constantly saying, well, how much goes to each bucket? And so it starts with municipal and industrial. That's us. That's the when you turn the tap on here at the Beatitudes. That's you're in the M&I category. We have tribal contracts, 15% agricultural, other excess. Forget that. There is no more excess. The tribal contracts are almost all for agriculture. So you can really add those two numbers together. And that gives you a much larger number than even the M&I. And the big one down here is contributions to Lake Mead. I'll talk a little more about that, but that is one of the most important things that's happened in the last few years, is we're trying to keep the system healthy. And to do that, we've given up, just in the last 2-3 years, over 300,000 acre feet of water that otherwise would be delivered here in Maricopa County and Pinal County. That now is staying in the Big Lake. And that's been a critical item. The fact sheet, I'll blow right past this, because let me just summarize it by saying that if you don't have water, you don't have an economy. Thank you, end of statement. We don't really need any more. But the total contribution is over $100 billion a year and over $2 trillion over the life of the project so far. So the compact, to give a little history, the Colorado Compact was an agreement between the seven basin states. And the seven basin states, starting from the north, are Wyoming, Colorado, Utah, Nevada, New Mexico, Arizona, and California. And you can tell that's a big part of the United States. That's a major section of our economy. And it's all service from this one poor little river. And in 1922, the state sat down in Santa Fe, and they reached an agreement. And they had a couple of critical items in that agreement. The first one was they divided the water, 7.5 million acre feet. Acre feet is, they constantly tell you it's about enough for three households to exist for a year. But think about an acre of land filled 1 foot deep with water. That's an acre foot. It's a lot of water. 333,000 gallons, if I remember correctly. So we divided the river, or they divided the river in 1922, and they said, okay, 7.5 go to the four upper basin states, 7.5 go to the three lower basin states. And then in 1944, they reached an agreement with Mexico. So under that international agreement, 1.5 million acre feet were allotted to the country of Mexico. Here's the problem, and I put it in capital letters. Only in the years when they reached that agreement was that much water actually flowing in the Colorado River. We have hardly since then reached the level that they assumed would be there forever, which was 16.5 million acre feet. The flow we now know, based on tree ring data and lots of hydrology over the time, is much closer to 10 to 12 million acre feet a year. Colorado just ain't that big. So as we're dealing with this future problem, I think the first thing to know is the river's been overallocated from day one, from the day that this compact was written and everybody went home thinking that they'd solve the water problems for the Western United States. Well, it was a nice thought, but it hadn't happened. So very short, it agreed that Arizona would get 2.8 million acre feet, California would get 4.4. Nevada, there weren't that many people living in Nevada in those days. Nevada got 300,000 acre feet, and they really resent it. I can tell you, the folks in Las Vegas are still a little cranky about that allocation. But there were no people in Las Vegas in 1922. There were not that many people in Phoenix. So Arizona then went, Arizona was the last signer. This is a little side note to history. But all the states, all the basin states signed the compact immediately, except us. Arizona is always the odd person out, right? So Arizona leaders decided that 2.8 was an insult. You look at the map, look how much of the, well, you can see it better, I think, in the previous slide. But a huge amount of the surface of the Colorado is in Arizona, or at least borders Arizona. Yeah. And so the theory in political circles in this state was that we need it, we need more of it. In fact, there was one state senator, his name was Coulter, there's a street name for him, a little south of here, who believed we should get it all.
Wow.
And he spent his entire career and his entire fortune on a project that he called the Highline Canal, which was to put a drainage ditch at Lee's Ferry and essentially divert the entire river across northern Arizona into Maricopa County. That was his dream, and that was seriously supported by leadership in this state for a very long time. And we went to court in the 1950s against California saying that we need a whole lot more than the 2.8. That was a 10-year trial. It was finally settled in the early 60s. And the determination, drum roll here, was that Arizona would get 2.8 million acre feet. Exactly what we had at the table in Santa Fe. There is one minor detail, however. They decided that the proceeds of the Gila River would not be counted. And that was the big deal in dispute. And so the Gila River, the Salt River Project, in essence, is not counted against our allocation of Colorado River water. And that was a victory. So that the big headline was Arizona wins the case. You have to put your tongue directly in your cheek before you believe that. But it does show you the history of controversy that surrounds this water. The famous saying, of course, is that Arizona, or in the West, whiskey's for drinking and water's for fighting. And that's very, very true. It wasn't until the early 60s, late 50s, early 60s, that Arizona finally signed on the compact. They figured it's inevitable. What we need now is a big ditch to bring the water to the center part of the state, because we can't possibly use it all with the river adjacent communities, Parker, Yuma, Bullhead City, which didn't exist then, but we'll throw it in for good measure. So they wanted to have an importation canal. Senator Hayden, they believe, was the only person with the seniority to get it. He got reelected in 1962, I believe, without coming back to the state. Because we knew he was the one guy in the Senate who could actually stand up for the interests in California. And he did. And so in 1968, the approval was granted, exactly 50 years ago, or a little more than 50. And he was signed by Lyndon Johnson, and that got us started. Okay, part of the system, part of the The whole activity here is generated by two reservoirs. They are the largest in the country, Lake Mead, Lake Powell. And I don't know if you saw your paper, if you had the Republic this morning. A few of us, I know, still actually read newsprint. But on the front page is the following article. Lake Powell set to hit its lowest water level this weekend. Not since they started filling the lake has it been at the level that I just turned off. Oh, okay. Good. All right. So look at the two big lakes. One is in the upper basin of Lake Powell, one is in the lower basin. It's at the end of the Grand Canyon. Lake Powell is basically built.
I didn't realize
it's the last place that they could build a dam in the upper basin. So they were determined to hold on to as much water as they possibly could. The chairman of the Committee on Insular Affairs in the U.S. House of Representatives was a guy named Wayne Aspinall, and he was determined that if they were going to approve the Central Arizona Project, they would get this dam. And so they got that and they filled it up, and it has been the dual check dams that monitor and control the river. I'm going to talk mostly about Lake Mead because that's in our area and it's the one that we are most concerned about, but the two work very closely together. Here's the entire system. I don't know if you can see all this, but there are a bunch of dams in the upper basin. The only one in the lower basin is Lake Mead, is Hoover Dam. Everything else is up in the Colorado area generally, a little bit in Utah. And they are low. They are close to historic lows at this moment. The ones we're going to talk mostly about is Lake Mead. That's it. The numbers that are seared in my brain anyway, 1,075 feet is the height of water that triggers the first major reduction under the agreements between the states. Goes down to 1,000 feet. 1,000 feet is what we call dead pool. That means it can't generate, there's no water that will pass the dam. So those are two pretty critical elevations that need to be kept in mind. In terms of supply, Lake Mead is at less than a third. It's at 33% of its capacity.
Wow.
So not too long ago, both of these lakes were full. And today they are just barely. So that is what we call the bathtub rain. And actually, this is a picture from several years ago. So the bathtub ring has gotten a lot bigger. And that's the deposit of basically lime, I guess, of calcium, that it shows where the high water was. And now you can see where the water is today. So what were we dealing with here? And it's a variety of things. The first one is the one I mentioned, that when they built the CAP, they were over-anxious. They thought there was much more water in the basin than, frankly, we now know it normally has. So that was the first mistake. The second one is the extraordinary growth of all of the western states. California led the way, but the others have not been too far behind. And so what originally was just a small amount of water for agriculture now is primarily directed at urban activity and at people, not so much at farming. Although the CAP still delivers most of its water today, as you saw in the earlier slide, to agriculture. That's not going to last much longer. And the next item is heat. There's no question that we're in a hot time, and with climate change, it appears that it's a long, strange hot time. And we are in a drought. We're in a 30-year drought right now. One of the worst that we've seen, not just in historic, but in even prehistoric time, based on tree ring data. So a whole lot of things have come together to the moment that we have right now. And I've got to say, everything needs to be on the table. All the current users need to look very hard at how they use water. There are certain things that are absolutely essential. There are others that probably we could argue are not so critical. I've listed a few of them there. If you're an avid golfer, enjoy it. Because one of the things I think that's going to go away are artificial lakes and, frankly, heavy turf golf courses. I don't see how we justify those in the kind of future that we have looking ahead. That's just one of the things. It's not the major one. The major one is agriculture. As I said, a big part of the Colorado River water goes to farmers. and they're the first ones to lose their allocation. We live in a desert. That's not a bad thing. If you go back through civilization throughout time, most great civilizations, I sometimes include Arizona as a great civilization, although I have my doubts sometimes. Most civilizations grew up in deserts. Think about it. They used irrigated agriculture. That required folks to get together and to have governments and to create civilizations. So there's nothing wrong with living in a desert. It's just the wrong part is if we assume we still live in the Midwest or the Great Lakes. I just got back from Lake Michigan. I wish we could get some of the surplus that they're enjoying right now. Lake Michigan is a foot and a half higher than it was just 3 years ago. That's a lot of water. But we haven't figured out yet a way to get it across the Midwest into Arizona. Okay, shortage in the future. I talked a little about what's coming up. And I'm going to ask your indulgence for a few fairly complicated slides. I know you're up to it, but this one shows what a tier one, you see the words DCP tier one?
Right.
That's the red line, and it's red advisedly. And that's the level of Lake Mead that you're seeing in this slide. So when it hits 1075, that's when the tier one shortage gets triggered. It has never happened before. We've operated this canal for over 35 years, and it has always been a time when we had extra water over and above the 1.5 million acre feet that CAP normally is entitled to, that we've been able to bring into central Arizona. We've used that, I think, very well. We put a lot of it in the ground for future use. And that's one of the safety valves that we have in place. But now, we're going into a time of much more severe. And what you see on this chart is what happens below 1075. At 1050, you have tier 2A. 1045, you have tier 2B. Those are important numbers simply because for the first time again in history, California stepped up. They don't pay any part. We in Central Arizona put all of the shortage when a tier one is declared. That's 512,000 acre feet. That's one third of the total amount that the CAP brings into Central Arizona. That goes away next year because we're very certain, based on the hydrology today, that the Secretary of Interior in August will walk to the podium and make a statement that we are in a tier one shortage. And Arizona, specifically us, are gonna take the entire haircut. Now, when you get down to these others, and this was all agreed to back in 2007, and then again in what we call the Drought Contingency Plan, the DCP, among all the basin states, that if you get below tier one, then the other states are gonna pick up and do part of the job. So California doesn't have to. I left out a fairly important detail. When Senator Hayden was negotiating the Central Arizona Project, California in those days had 44 congressmen. Arizona had three.
Yeah.
You can do the math. Yeah. It was not in our favor. We also had a hostile chairman of the House Interior Committee. Simply because he was from Denver, I guess. But the bottom line was we had to thread a lot of needles. And the most important was the one that said, if the CAP was built and that 1.5 million acre feet of Arizona water was passed on to the center part of the state, we agreed that we would be the last priority on the river. In other words, we would be the first cut in any shortage. And for 35 years, we haven't had a shortage, and we've been just making hay while the sun shone. But those days are over. And now we have to deal with the shortage. And this is what this chart basically is talking about. At 2B, the 1045 level, California steps up and puts, I think, 300,000 acre feet into Lake Mead. Now, we will have already put 700,000 acre feet into Lake Mead, so don't feel sorry for California. Please, don't do it. And then as you get down to tier three, that's 1025. Now you're in serious trouble. Now you're at a time when you're getting close to Deadpool. And that's not a good thing to do. So there will be some very dramatic actions before we get to that level. Okay, the next issue, and bear with me, the whole reason this all works, and the reason I said we did a good job of planning, is that from the very beginning, when the contracts for CAP water were initially laid out back in the 1980s, early 1980s, late 70s. Here's the way it was allocated. You can see at the top, you've got the other excess. Well, as I said, that went away. That was the extra 100,000 acre feet we were able to take in because they built the canal a little bigger than we had the legal right to import. And for a while there, nobody else was taking their full share. So we were able to suck it up, and we did. And we're proud of it. The ag pool is the green. NIA is called non-Indian ag. It essentially mostly is tribal water, but it has the name non-Indian ag. And then down here you have the tribal and the municipal and industrial. And then P3 at the very bottom is water that we're storing for other people who have a legal right to it. So that's water that can't be touched under any circumstances. Everything else is subject to our low priority on the river. But here's what happens. Okay. I think I covered all of that. If you look on the left, now you see the same chart, but we're taking away 512,000 acre feet. And you can see which users are going to be shorted. It's basically the green, the agricultural pool, and a big part of the non-Indian agriculture. And then if you go over to the right, that's the way it actually will be after a tier one shortage is declared. And you see there's a little bit of green. We have found some ways by taking water from other users that either don't need it or are willing to sell it and moved it into agriculture. So there's a less severe shock than there would have been otherwise. There's still some non-Indian ag in the orange. And then as you can see, the purple and the blue stay exactly as they are. That's us. That's tribal work and the municipal and industrial. So I think the point, if I can just hammer it home one more time, is that we're facing a new water reality. This year is tier one. Tier one we have expected for a long time. It is not a surprise. And I guess you couldn't call it a crisis. 512,000 acre feet is a lot of water to give up, to leave it in the river, to leave it in Lake Mead. But that's what we have to do to keep the river healthy and to make clear that this is going to continue to supply the water that it has. You have to look around the corner. You have to look at what's happening. And we all have charts based on most probable, least probable, flow situations, and we use it. There are two ways that we look at it. One is the last 30 years, and then project forward based upon the average of the last 30 years. The other is the last 300 years, if you can believe that. We have prehistoric data that we can use that will allow us to project. The last 30 years is the worst story, and it may be the most accurate because the rise in heat has truly been in the last 30 years. And that has had one very important impact that I, for one, did not really appreciate. Lake Powell is fed, as you can see from the map, from snow in the Rockies. Frankly, the wonderful rains that we've had here are worthless to the system I'm talking about. We have to pray every winter that skiing and Aspen and the other resorts in Colorado is really good because that's where our water comes from. And as that snow melts, hopefully it melts slowly. A fast runoff is disastrous. But if it melts slowly and it comes down through the watersheds, that's what feeds Lake Powell. Well, in May of this year, we knew we'd had a fairly poor snow year. So we weren't that optimistic. But the interesting part was the May projection, based upon past year experience, was X. What actually came into Lake Powell was one-third of X.
Wow.
And the reason was this. With the additional heat in the forests of the Rockies, the ground had dried out to an extent that when the snow melted, same amount of snow, but our projections were all wrong because the ground absorbed and held more water because there had been much greater evaporation over the past summer. That wasn't in the calculations before. It's one of the reasons why we're very, very concerned. And we're pretty sure, this is where the bad news really hits, that 2022 will be tier one. 2023, based on these projections, is tier two. And that's another 200,000 acre feet off the Arizona share. And it's very possible by 2025 that we'll be in tier three. And that's when it really begins to hurt. So when I say we've got to think again about how we use our water here in Central Arizona, I really mean it. It's not situation normal. It's not a crisis. It's we have time, we can work with this, but unless our leadership sits at the table and tries to figure out how do we use water in a desert more responsibly so we can maintain the really wonderful style of life and economy that we've developed in this state, it's going to take some sacrifice. And it's going to go back to the table like they did in 1922 and basically say, okay, the apple is the pie is not as big as we thought it was. It's now not this big, but it's about this big. Now, how do we responsibly divide that? And it means some people's legal rights are going to be, if not sacrificed, at least diminished. There's something in the West called the law of prior appropriation. Do you all know what that means? Not too many. Okay. Law of prior appropriation is, believe it or not, the law in the West, which means lose it or use it or lose it. The first in time, first in right. In other words, if I'm at the headwaters of a river and I divert X number of acre feet to feed my crops, I have the primary right. If I'm the first one to do that, the river could dry up except for my share, and I would still have a right to use that much water. And nobody below me would have any water at all. That's the way it works. But the flip side of that is really dangerous, because it means what if I cut back, for economic reasons or whatever, I cut back the amount of water I need on my farms. That basically under the law of private appropriation means my right to the water is smaller. So what am I incentivized to do?
Wow. Waste more water.
It. Pour it out on the land. Wow. Get rid of it. That's because if I don't do that, I give it up. So think of where conservation fits into that picture. Mm-hmm. Conservation for a major water user is foolish. And we've got to change that.
Wow, yeah.
I mean, all of us need to figure out a way to say conservation gives you credits. Conservation means that you still have some financial or economic ability to use what you had. Because otherwise, we've simply got a system that's going to encourage waste. So it's a new reality. Tier one, I've already talked about, it's going to require agriculture to take a huge hit. And now we need to look forward. And at the very end, the very last couple, we've got something called the 1030 consultation. I remember I saw the thing, tier three hits at 1025. Well, if it hits 1030, there is going to be an emergency meeting of all of the Western states. And they're going to sit down and say, this has got to be stopped. Because one of the things that is so terrifying here, and I'm sorry, Lake Mead and Lake Powell look like this. They're not straight-sided. They're V-shaped. No surprise. Most lakes have, you know, sloping shorelines, right? These happen to be in canyons, so they're a little different from other lakes. But the same thing is true. As you get down farther and further, the level is going to shrink quicker with the same amount of outflow. Right. So that's what we're dealing here right now. When we're looking at these sea level allocations, it means that these could happen pretty fast. In other words, it's taken a long time to get to 1075. We've played around with it for a long time. It's been inches from 1075 in past years, but we've always managed to stay above it. Now that it's gone below it, it could go much quicker than it has in the past. So what's next? We knew this was coming, so it's not a crisis. We've got to do a lot of things, and CAP is working on most of them. Desalinization, obviously the first thing that comes to mind. We got a big pilot project in the Gulf of Baja California. San Diego, as you probably know, is already using desalted water for some of their municipal supply. It's very expensive. But frankly, it's better than the alternative, which is none. We are working, and this is brand new, with the Los Angeles Water District, the Metropolitan District. They dump 200,000 acre feet of treated effluent, I think you all know what that means, into the bay every year. And they figured out if they can do treatment of that sewage water to drinking standards, and it's possible today, they can, in fact, put it in their system and take less water from the Colorado River. We're very interested in that. And so the CAP is actually investing money, starting on the 5th of August, next month, in helping Metropolitan come up with ways. We don't know how much it will cost yet, but I think you can imagine that it's pretty expensive. Some of the other ways that we're working include wheeling. Now, you may think that when a canal is partially empty, and that's what we're going to be in future years, that that's just wasted capacity. Well, maybe not. There are ways that other users, and some of them are groundwater users, could in fact pump water, put it in our canal, and move it to the municipal users. So that's just being looked into right now. The legal construct exists, and frankly, we think our canal is going to continue to be used very productively for a very long time, even when the Colorado River is putting less and less into our banks. We're also looking at agreements with the Salt River Project, the other major water project in Central Arizona. Right now, there's a very small interconnect between the two projects. It only goes one way. In the future, we think we can do some tunnels that will allow us to put water so that the Gila River watershed, which is 1 million acre feet a year, and right now is not in shortage. I should have said that earlier. Salt River is doing pretty well. They're a little low, but frankly, Lake Roosevelt and the others in the system are pretty close to capacity. So, you know, there's some good news within the state, and we're going to work with them so that we make sure that nobody is shorted if we can find ways to move the water to them. And there's one other thing that I just can't resist talking about. If anybody knows the hydrology of Maricopa County, you know that all the water flows from east to west. It's essentially the watershed of the Gila River. It ends up in the Colorado at Yuma. Well, the result of that whole geologic issue is that farmers in Gila Bend right now have water at about 6 feet. There are actually crops that die in the field because there's too much water.
Wow.
But it's not water you and I can drink. It's very what we call brackish. It's got a lot of pesticides and fertilizers in it because it's been through the fields. But there's a whole lot of it there. And so one of the things I'm pushing very hard at CAP is to see if we can do some, not invest in Los Angeles. Frankly, I've got a rash when I even mention that. But invest right here. Try to get some of the excess water that is under the ground in Arizona, but not being used today, and put that into productive capacity. And oh, by the way, the CAP canal runs through Buckeye. And we could put that, if we can get the legal rights to it and get it purified, it can go into the canal for downstream users. So those are some of the possibilities that we're looking at. They are audacious. And if you think about any of them, whether it's Buckeye water or desalinization in the Gulf of Baja California, there's usually about a 20-year startup period to get them online. So we need to start now. Hopefully this is the kind of wake-up call that will get people together to say the answers have to be big answers. It's not going to be, with all due respect to all the conservation that's going on in this room, low-flow shower heads and low-flow toilets are not going to solve our problem. Sure, they help, and there's no reason not to do them, but compared to some of these other demands, that's a, as they say, a rounding error. We need to have some big ideas and some big changes, and that's the kind of thing that needs to be talked about today. So these are sites. I encourage you to go to any of these websites. CAP has a good one with a lot of water news information. The Department of Water Resources, AWR, has a very good one, which is called newazwater.gov. And the boss of all of us, the czar of the river, is the Bureau of Reclamation, and their site is usbr.gov. A lot of information out there. I hope I haven't completely overwhelmed folks with facts, figures, and a lot of reminiscences, but we sit in a time of great challenge, great peril, but also great opportunity. And I think you should not be despair, but on the other hand, I hope everybody will take the message clearly that this is the time for some big changes. In Arizona, that's not really a surprise. Back in 1912, Arizona was the first Bureau of Reclamation major project. The Salt River Project was the first one to have been tried in this country. Roosevelt Dam was one of the very first of the big reclamation dams. Subsequently, they went all over the United States. But we were number one. The farmers in central Arizona mortgaged their farms to build that project. After that got paid off and they were doing well, then in the 60s and 70s, the CAP came along. You can see the cycle. We're at about the next 50 years right now. And it's time that we dealt with the water program one more time. Won't be the last time, but it is a very important, I hate to use the word watershed, in terms of our thinking. So I'm invited to answer any questions, and if there's time, I'll go on to talk about dark money. But I know this is complicated, and I know there are probably some very knowledgeable people in this audience who I have either catch me on something I misstated or have a question that perhaps I can answer. So thank you much, and Barry says, know your water.
Terry, I lived in Kearney, Arizona for 15 years, and we were subject to the loan equity decree of 1936. And up the river on the Gila, the mine, a Sarpo mine, got a whole lot. And down the river, the Indians got a whole lot. And we were in between, which had a very small amount. We developed a plant to treat the sewage, and when it came out, it was clearer than the water coming down the river. But we could not have the people drink that for psychological reasons. But anyway, we dumped it back into the Gila, and therefore we got credit for it in a, I guess you'd call it a water bank. Now, are any of the other cities that I think you mentioned are trying to treat this? And if so, will that help the area that we are living in right now?
The grow equity is an important part of Arizona history, and thanks for bringing that up. The cities already do a lot of water purification, and I think the next step is that that psychological problem barrier that you mentioned is probably going to have to be dealt with very soon, because we're going to be drinking it. But it's exactly what Los Angeles is trying to do with our money. They want to clean their discharge to a level that it will become drinkable and therefore part of their regular municipal supply. So the technology is there, it just needs cash to implement. And a change in our psychology. That's one of the big things that has to be on the table. Phoenix, for example, has sold almost all of its discharge to Arizona Public Service. That's what cools the Palo Verde nuclear power plant. So there's probably not a lot of Phoenix water that could be used because it's already allocated. But other municipalities, I think, could probably do a lot more than they do today. So it's a great point, and it's one of the things that has to be on the table.
Thank you.
We've been here for about 50 years, and when we first got here, the population of Maricopa County was a little under 2 million. The bottom line is, now that we're somewhat over 4 million, I'm wondering what the mitigation will be for our water supply if, in spite of the weather, if the population keeps expanding here, as it has been for 50 years so far as I know.
It's a great question, and one of the sort of misunderstood facts, but it gets quoted a lot, is that today in Maricopa County, we're actually using less water in the municipalities than we used 30 years ago. That sounds pretty good because those municipalities have doubled in size. What is not in that figure when it's quoted to you is that most of that water still is used for agriculture. So as agriculture shrinks, the total demand for water goes down. People use less water than crops. And that's just a hard reality. We could, if we do what is called for in these maps, we can continue to grow. I think it should be with eyes wide open. And by that I mean every industry is not going to work in a water-constrained environment. Steel mills, for example, are probably a very bad choice for a future of Arizona, but there's certainly most of the intellectual property work uses relatively little water. Silicon chips use quite a bit, so I'm sort of putting that off on the side. But I just think we have to be careful about how we grow. It doesn't mean that suddenly the door closes and nobody else gets in. I think that would be crazy and unrealistic. But I do think that we have to, as Arizonans, we have to be careful. We have to recognize that we are in a water-constrained environment, something that is hard for many people in this community to say, and act accordingly. So it doesn't stop the growth. We plan well. As agriculture gets less and less of the supply, more is available for people. But it's not infinite, and it needs to be planned carefully. Sir.
Hey, good morning, Terry. Thanks a lot for your talk. This is such an important subject. You know, it seems like the agricultural use is so obviously kind of low-hanging fruit here, at least in terms of addressing a good chunk of our problem. Do you think that, do you have any idea that our governor and our political leadership here in Arizona is sort of going to take any action or steps with respect to the agricultural usage? And then some of the, you know, voluntary restrictions or cutbacks and other types of usage, things that seem so obviously heading in our direction, but there just seems to be zero effort by our current leadership to address the problem, let alone take any meaningful action. I just wondered if you knew inside whether they're just going to wait for these dire tears to sort of force their hand, or whether they're willing to take any steps at some point.
That is a tantalizing slow pitch. Thank you. Let me just deal with a little reality, and I think this is bipartisan reality. We traditionally in Arizona have had extraordinary congressional leadership in the area of water management. I mentioned Carl Hayden three or four times. He certainly was extraordinary. But the guy that was behind him that frankly did the late night homework was Morris K. Udall.
Yeah.
One of the brightest people in Congress, maybe a low bar, but he certainly was. And a guy who understood Arizona water better, I think, than almost anybody else. And he had a Republican compatriot named John Rhodes.
Yep.
They worked together for us as a hand in a glove and did an amazing job in doing the legislative machinations, whatever it took, to get the CAP passed. I happen to be lucky enough to be in the gallery for a lot of the testimony in 65, 66, because my dad was one of the people giving testimony on behalf of the state. And watching those two people work was amazing. We do not have anybody even close today. John Kyle, give him certainly credit. He was a water lawyer when he went to the Senate, and he understood water issues and presented Arizona's position very, very well. We don't have anybody in Kyle's position today. In the Arizona legislature, it is safe to say that no one, Republican or Democrat, is really expert on, there's some that know a lot more than others, but there's nobody that you turn to say, like Herb Gunther was for many years. Many of you probably remember Representative Gunther. He represented the Yuma area, but he was also the head of our Department of Water Resources for many years. A tough, tough guy. He beat me up many times, but somebody who understood our needs and was able to take the long view. Wes Steiner, I don't know if anybody has ever looked at the history books or maybe experienced the great Mr. Steiner, but he came from California, and most of us were very suspicious of him, but he ran the original DWR when Bruce Babbitt set it up and did an amazing job of the long-term planning for this state. Don't have anybody close to his league, unfortunately, today. So we have a problem in terms of legislative leadership. And as the next campaign comes around, please ask candidates to give you a definitive answer into what they intend to do in the water crisis, because I really want to hear their answers, and you should too, because we need more. We need some real strength in that area.
I haven't heard anything about cloud seeding for a long time until I read just recently that one or more of the Middle East countries was going to embrace employ that. Has that technology been given up on, or is it just it takes so many shekels to do it that you know, it's not worth the cost?
Well, it's sort of the other way around. I'm not a fan of cloud seeding. I figure that there's a certain amount of rain that's going to fall, and that what cloud seeding does is it determines where it's going to fall more than actually increasing the supply. And so it can create flooding if it's, you know, sort of has the wrong result. We do a lot of cloud seeding. At the CAP, we pay for it because it is the cheapest of the available so-called augmentation processes. And frankly, I think we're scratching each other's behind. It's not adding to the total water supply in the West, but it is changing where it rains. And so it's not, and it also is, and here I'm completely out of my depth, but it seems to me when you put iodine into the clouds, you're producing some kind of pollution on the ground. And they say it's completely unimportant, but it is an addition, and I would rather work on some of the things that we tried to talk about here rather than trying to change where it rains. But we are doing it because everybody says we gotta do something. Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
Up here.
There you go. We do want to save some time for Jerry's other topic.
In water gathering systems, and I hope that the town of Phoenix is exploring every darn way that they can in the movement of water, and we're not, they haven't done that. I think that with that park system that they're developing out there, they can use, they can put a lot of things in there. Anyway, every large city, or even smaller, should have a system that they will gather water and dispose it wherever is the best place. Let's believe it that way.
Absolutely.
Water systems are very important in the city of Phoenix, Miracle County, you name it. They have to sit down and see what they can do. Thank you.
Thank you, and I couldn't agree more. I mean, the rain that's coming down today, and I can tell you from my own experience as mayor, is termed wastewater, because we don't know what to do with it. It runs in our streets, and then it goes into big culverts, and it gets dumped down in the river. We're the only person in the world, or the only group in the world, that considers that rivers' proper place is underground, and that water that actually flows in our yards is waste. So I agree with you 100%. We need to figure, and until very recently in Phoenix, and I think it applied to all the other municipalities, what you call a gray water system was illegal.
Wow.
Because they thought it created places for mosquitoes to breed, and they're right, or water that they couldn't control from the municipality. So it wasn't pure. But if we can save some of this rain and use it for our yards in the future, I think that's a very important part. So why does every piece of water that we get have to be treated to drinking water standards? I think we are looking at a dual system. I'm sorry, I'm getting into the science fiction area here, but I think in the future, we're probably gonna have drinking water out of one tap, and we're gonna have bathing water out of another tap. What's wrong with that?
Yeah.
And then what goes down the drain, much of it, I'm not talking about the raw sewage, I'm talking about the stuff that comes from cleaning and showers, whatever, that can go into the yard if we had a way to keep it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
All that, however, requires money. And the homeowners so far are not, only a few are willing to invest in the cisterns that are necessary. And only recently has Phoenix and other municipalities seen the light and said, yeah, we live in a desert, maybe we should save the water instead of letting it just go as waste. So thank you for that question, that's real important.
Okay,
can we take 5 minutes to run quickly through dark money?
Sure, absolutely.
I appreciate that, and this is a political sidelight, but I want to emphasize it's a nonpartisan political sidelight. And I will run through these slides very quickly. I've got, I think, 5 minutes, and so I don't want to overindulge. I've already talked way too long.
No,
but
not
there
at all.
Is a connection between dark money, that means anonymous cash in our political system, and some of the things we've talked about here. Because believe me, some of the folks who are gonna fight every step of change in this system are gonna do it anonymously.
Yeah.
And I think you all know, I've talked about this here before, that's what we're dealing with. We're talking about anonymous cash in the political system trying to influence our vote. And if we don't know who it is that's trying to convince us, if it's one of these nonsense names, like I use here, Americans for Peanut Butter. Now, maybe peanut butter is a real cause, but Americans for Prosperity is a major dark money player financed by now the Koch brother. And who's not for prosperity? I mean, I think that's a great name, but it doesn't tell you one thing about what they're spending their money to try to convince you to do. And I think that's ultimately, short of keeping people from actually voting, having political speech anonymous is the most toxic thing you can do to our democracy.
Amen.
Because it erodes people's confidence in their vote. You see a lot of stuff coming over the airways and you don't know where it comes from. How can you say you're casting an eligible vote if it's in part based upon that information? And so I believe we have a right, should have a right in this state, to know the original source. I mean the original source, not this nonsense, no name, nonprofit that's in the middle, which is the way it's done. But the actual person or corporation that forked over, earned the money and forked it over into the system to try to influence us. So I talk about the whole arrangement here, but I think confidence in our democracy has been eroded because of dark money, anonymous cash.
No question.
And part of our negative feeling about politics and politicians today is as a result of the millions and millions of dollars that are spent anonymously. Because think about it. Somebody spending anonymous money has no reputational risk. They're not held to any standards to protect their reputation or even to tell the truth. And usually the ads that they pay for are negative. Because it's far easier to tear somebody down than it is to build them up. And so one of the reasons I think there's so much negativism in our political discourse is because so much of it is irresponsible. So much of it does not have an original source to take responsibility and to take the legal hit. So it hurts. Now this is, as I said, nonpartisan. I don't quote Barry a lot, although I like it more and more every day. But he said a limited campaign spending eats at the heart of the democratic process. And then he also said something about peanut butter that I thought was pretty amusing. So I put that in there too. And here, back in 2014, I think we all lived through one of the ways that it hurts us. Our beloved power company, Arizona Public Service, basically, for years, under previous leadership, had taken an absolute position that they would never spend any money from the corporation to influence votes for the Corporation Commission, who regulates the regulated utilities and determines how much they can charge you and me. Well, in 2014, they kind of changed that.
Yep, they did.
And we all knew that we're active in politics in those years, that something was going on that was different, but we had no idea what it was. And if you asked APS directly, they would say, well, we can either confirm and deny that we were involved in the race. They didn't deny it, but they didn't affirm it either. And they didn't say what they were doing, how much, or where. Well, we now know, 5 years later, that they spent $10 million to elect two people to the Corporation Commission. So a five-member board determines utility rates, right? And those two were enough to pass a $95 million rate hike the next year.
Yep.
And we all paid it.
Yep.
So does it hurt you? Yes, it hurts. Because I don't think if those people, there are two things that I can say for sure. One, if those people had said in all the ads that favored them, paid for by Arizona Public Service, I think most people would have thought at least twice, maybe three times, about whether that was a vote they wanted to cast in favor of those individuals. The second thing was the race. I know many of you, Lois in particular, will remember it vividly. It was really nasty. And one of the incumbents was a woman named Sandra Kennedy. She's a black businesswoman, and they'd had ads against Sandra that made her look like a criminal. The only thing they didn't show was numbers under her picture. And frankly, if Arizona Public Service had had to put their name on those ads, they never would have run. because they do have reputational risk, and they would not have attacked a black woman in that scurrilous and unsupported way. But the anonymous guy was something called the Plus 50 Association out of Virginia, and a group here called the Free Enterprise Club. You know, what's not to like about being part of the Free Enterprise Club? But you didn't really think that they were going to do the attack ads on Sandra Kennedy. But that's exactly what they did. So it's a continuing saga in Arizona. We have a right, it goes back to 1912 when the Constitution of Arizona was originally enacted. We have a right to initiative, referendum, and recall. And as you probably know, so one of those factoids in Arizona history, that the initial, President Taft, initially turned down the Arizona Constitution because we recalled judges. And President Taft was going on to a career as a judge.
Yep.
And he thought that was a very bad idea. So he said, no, we're not going to approve it, you're a constitution. Arizona legislature dutifully redid the Constitution, took out recall of judges, and President Taft approved it, as did Congress. That's why we're the 48th state instead of the 47th. New Mexico snuck in ahead of us. We were supposed to come in together on the same day, but they didn't have that little problem. So we ended up being the last one in 1912. But what did Arizona do? The same year?
Amended the
they put back, and they amended their constitution and put back the recall of judges. It's never been done in our state's history, to my knowledge, but we thought it was important. Well, equally important, maybe more important, is initiative and referendum. Referendum, the ability to, I think I've got some stats here on it. Yeah, there it is. If 5% of the vote for the previous vote for governor, you can refer any bill that the legislature passed to a vote of the people. So it's on the vote, and we get to do the same thing the governor does. We can either approve it or veto it. So that's a referendum, and we'll have a little more to say about that in a minute. Legislative initiative, 10% of the last vote. These numbers are, yeah, no, those are right. 237,000, and then if you want to change the Constitution, it takes 356,000 signatures. That's a very important right. It's a right the legislature happens to hate. They don't think we have the smarts to actually initiate legislation. So they work very hard to stop it. Now, my little effort, and many of you have been helpful, and I thank you for that, to try to stop the anonymous cash. And we have gotten, in 2018, we filed, I thought, enough signatures. But the Supreme Court had a little different ruling on it, and they kept us off the ballot. Last time we were there, we had 300,000 signatures in the bank. We had 3 months to go, and COVID hit in March. And the result was we had to pull back our volunteer efforts. I didn't want people to be in harm's way, so we weren't able to file. We're trying again in 2022. Lois Bow, I know, has some petitions. She, Lois, bless her heart, has always got a petition. And I've got some more here if anybody would like to just take one for friends, family, anybody you happen to see that is a registered Arizona voter. We need their signatures because it's a big job to get 237,000 valid votes, but valid signatures. We've got until the 8th of July of next year to do it, so we still have some time. But frankly, I'm a nervous type, and I want to get as many as we can as soon as we can. What's different? This is, last time we tried to do it constitutionally, that, as you know, was a bigger number. This time we're doing it legislatively. I think it has the same result. We were very careful to try to achieve the same result in terms of rights for people. But it's 120,000 fewer signatures. That's a big deal. It has a new name. We're calling it Stop Doc Money instead of Outlaw Dirty Money. You may remember the earlier one. I still think it's descriptive. It's still good. If you Google Outlaw Dirty Money, you will get to the same website as Stop Dark Money, so don't be confused. The old name still works. There are triggers to change, but it's not a big deal. It's $50,000. A campaign statewide has to spend at least $50,000 before it triggers the disclosure requirements. If it's a local campaign, it's at least $25,000. It was lower before, but frankly, before it was issued campaign by campaign, this time it's comprehensive. So if you've got a nonprofit 501c4, which is anonymously spending money on campaigns, you look at all of the campaigns they've tried to influence in the election cycle. That is a slight difference. And this is new. I think it's important, given a decision the Supreme Court just made. If a donor is contributing to a 501c4 and they don't want their money used for political ads, they can say so. And if they don't say so, then it's considered usable, but they have the opportunity to opt out. And I think that protects us legally. And there's a new website. Please go to stopdarkmoney.com. And it has the full text of the initiative. What's the same? Okay. Requires all contributions over $5,001. So if you're going to give, if you want to stay anonymous, just give $5,000. I know this is important to everybody here. and if you're willing to be disclosed, add that extra buck. But it's, the important thing is the word original source. It's not the last person that wrote a check, because that's usually the phony baloney one. It's the one who earned the money in the first place. Arizonans have the right to know. I think that's critical. Citizen Clean Elections Commission will be our enforcement arm. They will write the rules. They will do the investigations. And here's something that's happening today. This is a group called Arizona Deserves Better, and I'm working with them. They've got three referenda that they're working on, and today is their day of action, the 24th. So all over the state of Arizona are places to sign. I don't happen to have, and Lois, maybe you do, but I don't have any of the referendum petitions. But they are trying to get three laws, and here they are, that were passed by the legislature that they think we ought to at least have the chance to vote on. And so these are the three. I'll summarize them very quickly. The first one does not allow... that's the one that purges the PEBL. PEBL stands for Permanent Early Voting List. Well, it's now the temporary early voting list. It's not permanent at all because they're able to go back and purge the voting list. The second one stops elected officials from receiving private grants. You probably have been following the recount, the so-called fraudit. That's all anonymously funded.
Yep.
But they think nobody, anonymous or otherwise, should help election officials make voting easier. So they made it illegal in the state of Arizona. That's going on the ballot if we get 180,000 signatures. And 1819, this is a beauty. This is supposedly an anti-fraud measure. By the way, there's no evidence that we have fraud in Arizona elections. Right. In fact, we should be very proud of the way bipartisan people have run elections in this state. It's one thing we do very well. But
Gary,
for some reason...
You have those petitions too.
You have them up. I figured you would.
Bring them with me because okay. You know you're going to talk about them.
Well, I could not. Today's the day of action. So anyway, the last one says, in the future... Okay, we have a source. You have some of the petitions. They need slightly fewer signatures than I do for Stop Dark Money, but they have to get the signatures in 90 days from the end of the legislative session. So I believe that's September 23rd, 24th, something like that, is when the expiration for those petitions hits. This last one, I just want to emphasize, and I will be done. It gives you 10 supposed anti-fraud activities that have to be incorporated in the future ballots that we use. And this comes from this level of, I believe, unjustified paranoia about past elections. But some of the anti-fraud measures that they say that out of the 10, election officials have to use at least three. And they include having holographs included in the ballot. It's like they were currency. So they're trying to use the same level of security that you would have for the dollar bills coming out of the mint. There's one that requires them to be individually identified. And frankly, I thought we had secret balloting. And the idea that you would individually identify a ballot and then account for it at the end of the day is an anathema to our secret ballot situation. So think about your privacy when you're thinking about these particular bills. But let me just say that it's important. These are stopping voter suppression. We're working together as a team across the state of Arizona. There's another group of referendums involving education. As you probably know, the legislature tried to undo what the voters passed last time. It was Prop 208. And they basically figured out ways around that. And there are three more referenda that may be represented here, I'm not sure, that also try to undo that particular effort. I'm sorry, I'm not talking. Okay. Let me just emphasize that this is a totally nonpartisan. I as a career of 30 years as a lawyer, I don't think I've ever quoted Justice Antonin Scalia on any legal point. But I've become an admirer of Justice Scalia in this particular area. And I'd like to read to you what he said in a 2010 opinion. For For my part, I do not look forward to a society which thanks to the Supreme Court campaigns anonymously, hidden from public scrutiny and protected from the accountability of criticism. This does not resemble the home of the brave. This is one of the most conservative justices in history, and he believed that we all should campaign with our own voice and not do it anonymously, and I think that's exactly right. So thank you for your attention. I'm sorry I've gone a little bit over, but I really appreciate all of you.
Very important points that we all need to know about.